Let's look briefly at God's initiation of salvation. A lot of people get real nervous. You know, they get real edgy. They say, oh, you know, isn't it, you know, controversial? Well, not if you stay with the Bible. It's so interesting. If you get into endless theological debate, it's very messy. But if you just stick with what the Bible says, it's very marvelous. God has always been the initiator of salvation. Just think with me. You don't have to turn there. Genesis 3. What happened in Eden when Adam and Eve chose to turn from God and go into sin? What happened? As soon as they sinned, did they start going, oh, God, come save us. Please help us. No, they started hiding under the bushes. And they were cringing and cowering. And what did God do? God came and looked for them. God came and began walking through the garden. Now, an infinite, eternal, omniscient God who could see, who has laser-like eyes, didn't need to look around for them, but he was trying to help them. And he was walking through the garden. He says, where are you, Adam and Eve? Where are you? Who initiated the rescue effort? God. God. God always initiates the process. We just hide like we have been since our first parents tried to hide their sin from God. How about when the earth in chapter 6 of Genesis was so full of sin that it grieved God's heart that he ever created mankind? What did God do? Did he wait for a delegation to come looking for him and say, what are we going to do to get out of this mess? Every imagination of our hearts only evil continually. And the earth is filled with violence. Can you come and help us? No. It says in Genesis 6 that God looked and graciously reached down and took one man and his family and demonstrated his grace. In fact, the first time grace appears in the Bible, it's in Genesis 6. And it says, and Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord. If you're saved this morning, and because of that grace we are saved this morning, it's only because we found grace in God's sight. And God graciously saved Noah. How about the pagan moon-worshipping city of Ur? I mean, they were all worshiping the moon god and their idols. And God looked down in Genesis 11 and 12, and he found one man. And he set his affections upon that man. And you know him well. His name was Abram. And God came down to that man and called out to him and said, Abram. And he started a relation with him. And Abraham responded. Now, how do you say, I mean, how does God say he does this? Is it presented in the scriptures that we seek him? Or is it presented in the scriptures that he seeks us? Well, the answer, of course, is in the New Testament. If you want to turn with me back from James to John's gospel, if you ever want to know what God's doing, what God's like, what he means, how he's going to do something, look at Jesus. Because remember, we saw last week, Jesus is the exact reflection of the infinite character of God. God is immaterial. He is spirit. He is invisible. So if you want to see God, you have to look at Jesus Christ. He is the one who represents the image of God. And if we want to see God's explanation of his process of salvation, we must look in the life of Jesus. And in John 6, starting in verse 37, with the numberless crowds trampling upon one another to get near Jesus, we find him explaining to us salvation. Now, I want you to think about the picture. I mean, this is the high point. Jesus, if you charted Christ's ministry, it would look like this. Started unknown, went stratospheric, crested right here in chapter 6, and then just went off the charts in the pits. I mean, they killed him, literally. Okay, that's the picture of Jesus' life. And what happened is he went from nothing in obscurity and began with his first miracle at the wedding of Cana. And all of a sudden the word got out without newspapers, radio, nightly news, nothing, no internet. And people by word of mouth started talking about it. And his popularity just went up, up, up. And right here in John 6, the multitudes are countless. They're just trampling each other. He has to feed them by the thousands. And people are looking, they're saying, wow, this is great. Everybody's believing. Jesus said, no. Look at verse 37. No. He says, all that the Father gives me will come to me. And the one who comes to me, I'll certainly not cast out. Now look down at verse 44. Because, by the way, what happens is Jesus starts talking very pointedly about what salvation is. You see, Jesus didn't try and lure them in and kind of coddle them. And Jesus just told it straight. And when he had the multitudes, he told them exactly what he demanded from them. He told them exactly what the requirements were. And you know, he went from right here, and it says at the end of John 6, it says the vast majority of people stopped following Christ. And that's why his popularity plummeted, because they didn't like what he said. What did he say? Well, look at verse 44 of John 6. No one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draws him, and I will raise him up in the last day. Look at verse 66. Folks didn't like that doctrine. Never have. Still don't. Verse 66. As a result of this, many of his disciples withdrew and were not walking with him anymore. See, people don't like the fact that they're not in charge of their life. And they don't like the fact that God is supreme over all, Lord. And when the Lord explained this, verse 37, that every person who is saved is a gift from the Father to the Son, expressing God's love. That's amazing. The Father gives to Jesus those who come to him. And the one who comes to him, all who come to him, he'll never, never cast out. But they don't even come, verse 44, unless the Father draws them. See, God initiates salvation. And the Lord explained that.